Hi guys, welcome to Avid Secret Studio. My name is Gaurav and I'm joined by this awesome guest today, and I'm super excited to get into a session and really dive in. So today we have Nate Alford, and dude, you've done some amazing work out there. We've been speaking for a while.
Yes, sir.
Also a carbon owner, which is great. I had to plug that in there.
Yeah,
nice. But yeah, you've worked with Young Blue, Rihanna, Kanye, you said, yeah. So many names, but I always ask my guests to give an introduction to themselves. So Nate.
I'm Nate Alford, engineer, vocal producer, mixer, born and raised based in LA. Specializing mainly doing vocal recording, vocal production, just capturing the best vocals that I possibly can. That's pretty much the most important element of any song that we all listen to and sing along with. So that being the most important thing, I just try to always focus on that. And Pro Tools is my the way I do it, the way I capture it every time. I need consistency to give the artist the most comfortable experience, to let them do what they got to do and be creative and not be inhibited by worrying about anything. So every time we tap in and every time we sit down, it's Pro Tools first.
Love it. Thank you so much, Nate. So today you've actually bought a session, and thank you so much for doing this, because mm-hmm. I know how hard it is in the industry to mm-hmm. be able to get sessions and stuff,
mm-hmm.
right? So thank you so much. And we're going to be diving through really technical stuff,
mm-hmm.
to kind of basic stuff as well,
yeah.
touching mm-hmm. on kind of how you mix, because obviously mm-hmm. your mix, as I was saying before, mm-hmm. they really do resonate, man. Just the way the vocals cut through,
yeah.
the way the vocals sit. Mm-hmm. And without you even telling me that was your thing, mm-hmm. I was like, I can hear it. Like the record with Drake, mm-hmm. was it Your Mind?
Your Mind Still.
Amazing. Yeah. That was obviously the first time I heard of Young Blue. Then mm-hmm. after that, it's been like regular occurrence. Mm-hmm. My Spotify yeah. playlist is just full of it. Yeah. So yeah. What session have you got today? And what
I've
we
got
be
a session by two artists I work with. It's mm-hmm. Dame Dala and Blast. It's a record called Overnight. It's the record that came together earlier this year in L.A., and they met up in the studio and exchanged some ideas, and we cut a record on the spot.
Wow. And was this recorded on carbon as well?
Yes.
So oh, it was?
So I take my carbon everywhere I go, and I just, it's easy. It makes my process for getting in, getting out, traveling, and giving myself consistency and something that I know what I'm getting, so that I can trust my ears, know what I'm getting, and know, and anytime I'm not hearing something correctly, I know it's not my interface. I know it's something else. So this is a session where I pull up my carbon, set up the vocal mic, my vocal chain. I go through the Neve, I go through CL1B, and whatever vocal mic we decide to go with that day, whether it be a C800, a 251, an 87, whatever. And as soon as we're set up, we're locked in and ready to record.
Wow. And how was like the DSP feature for you? Because obviously, personally, like I love it. Yeah. I love offloading processing, yeah, as you've yeah. seen. Like, it's just so much easier.
So much easier.
So have you set up like a DSP, like as such, like templates and?
I have. I use it sometimes, but what happens to a lot of times with something, I guess we haven't probably discussed it, yeah. but it's something I encounter with different artists. Certain artists will have their own templates sometimes, something that they want to record
wow.
through. So this is why
really?
I love the carbon even more, because artists want their song to sound finished as they're recording it. So they'll uh-huh. have, plugins on the master bus, and we'll record with them on. And before, if you did that, it would be a latency, it's a problem. With my car, when I saw that the carbon did that, even without using the DSP mode, which is amazing, I highly recommend DSP, but when you can't do that, and the artist wants to record with their L2 or whatever on the master bus, the carbon still allows you to get so low latency vocally, and that's so important for artists. So
sharp.
Important.
I didn't even think of it that way.
No, it's insane. It's
everyone
literally
always
insane.
Sticks to like the engineer thing, and that's a good thing. Like now, I don't know if you saw, we have like Pro Tools Artist, which mm-hmm. is our new kind of like tier.
Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
And it's like just something literally what it says on the tin. Open up your laptop.
Right.
You plug your headphones in. Mm-hmm. You don't need an interface, right. and it's just Pro Tools Artist.
Exactly. Yeah.
And it does that, and even that. Now you made me think, like, wow, like. Having templates as an artist is so vital.
So vital.
And then you have like all the other ones like Pro Tools Studio and stuff, mm-hmm. and you can, engineering or production,
yeah.
whatever
yeah.
it may be.
Yeah.
All right, guys, we're going to dive right in now. So Nate, should we grab our headphones and walk through?
Sure. So this is this record is called Overnight. It's by Dame Dala and Blast, produced by Khalil. So this is one of my favorite records that I got to work on the last year or so. Came together really quickly, got done really quickly. So let's dive into it.
Yeah, there's not a lot going on straight away.
Straight away.
It looks really good.
Yeah, it's pretty clean. you know, I cut to vocal here, good amount of compression going in, mm-hmm. and then, you know, to a two track, and then kept it pretty simple.
And what other output gear did you have going in? Because I know you said you had the Carbon, obviously.
Carbon.
Was it straight into the Carbon? Did you have a pre-amp?
So yeah, so we'll go from either the C800 or the mm-hmm. 251 or U87.
Wow.
Go straight out of that into a Neve. Straight out of that into a 11, usually 1176 or CO1B uh-huh. or LA2A, depending on what compressor we want. Straight out of that, line out right into the Carbon.
Wow. It's not a lot.
Yeah.
That's actually not a lot. That's pretty good. Cool. No, the 73 is like essential.
Yeah.
I mean, that's what I love on vocals as well. It's like the 73 just sounds so great.
Absolutely.
And obviously C800 is amazing as well. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And then straight into Carbon. Then your Carbon chain would be kind of like, do you have like a recording chain?
I usually go pretty light. I just go straight off to the record track with EQ compression, and then that'll go straight to a reverb and delay if needed. Wow. And then I'll have, you know, some tune on there, some auto tune or whatever.
Amazing.
So yeah, it's pretty simple. I keep it simple for my work. I like the artist to feel very natural, but also controlled, where they can be loud and then not, you know.
Yeah. I remember I had this quote came up from someone from LA. She was a singer and she mm-hmm. tried out Carbon in London.
Mm-hmm.
This is just before the pandemic. And she had, she was obviously like in that LA, like Capitol Records vibes,
right.
the big studios.
Right.
And obviously if someone who doesn't record herself, she was very like, oh wait, I need to, when I come back to London, I can't go back to LA.
Yeah.
I need to know how I can record myself.
Yeah.
Therefore, when she tried on Carbon, she was actually shocked. And she was like, wow, this actually allows me to sound good. But as you just said there, like as natural as you can be, with like too much stuff happening. But as an engineer, you know, okay, I'm doing the bit that I need to do. And that's all I need to capture, which is awesome, man.
For me, it's consistency. Yeah. I fly with mine. It goes everywhere I go. Mm-hmm. It goes on the plane with me. It's consistency. I know what I'm getting. The artist knows what they're going to get. It's just a comfortability that it provides me. And I will never probably ever use another interface, personally.
Yeah, I agree. all right, man. Can we have a little list?
Yeah,
is that cool?
Yeah, I done waited on this moment my whole life. Price ain't cheap, I paid the fee, I had to sacrifice. Wasn't perfect, put that work in just to earn a stripe. I've been working, that's for certain, this ain't overnight. Yeah, perfect timing, that's how you know it's right. Yeah, yeah, let's make a toast, the future looking bright. Wasn't perfect, put that work in just to earn a stripe. I've been working, that's for certain, this ain't overnight.
Look,
man, that was amazing. There were so many. The thing is, when I'm looking at the session itself, mm-hmm. it seems like there's not much going on.
Mm-hmm.
And when I'm hearing it back now and I'm checking every element in my head, I'm like, wow, it's like I can feel every element separately.
Yeah.
It's like really strange to explain it, but like that kick when it was punching through,
then
it changed up a little bit. And I guess that's like the bridge section.
Yeah.
So yeah, man, I want to let's talk through it, man.
Absolutely. Shout out Khalil for producing a crazy beat.
Yeah, that was amazing.
That's Damian Lillard. Shout out Damian Lillard, Dame Dollar, and Blast, amazing artists. For making a great record.
Yeah.
It all starts for me with the record. So without that, there's, you know, nothing to really go from. So yeah, pretty straightforward. I kind of have everyone on their separate vocal bus just to keep everything, you know, for me, I kind of keep my hook on a bus, you know, my hook artist, so that even if it's the same artist, I keep it all separated so I can control, you know, each vocal. So on this red track here, that's Blast. On the blue track.
So you've recorded Blast as well?
Yes.
Okay, all right. And this is a two track that you're mixing to, or
yeah.
You have stems. Okay, cool.
Yeah,
perfect.
And it depends. Like on certain songs, I'll get the stems, mm-hmm. and through whatever DAW producers use, sometimes they'll give me stems, and it doesn't sound as good as a two track. So instead of taking it back a step or giving the artist something that they're not used to, sometimes we use a two track because. You know,
going back to simplicity, what works?
Exactly.
What works is the most important thing, right?
Absolutely.
There's no right and wrong answer to any of this. It's
100%.
Like, if it works for you, it works.
Yeah, absolutely. So I guess start with the hook. You know, I keep everything to a bus, so I hear.
Okay.
Yeah, I done waited on this moment my whole life. Price ain't cheap, I paid the fee, I had to sacrifice. Wasn't perfect, put that work in just to earn a stripe. I've been working, that's for certain, this ain't overnight. Yeah, perfect timing, that's how you know it's right. Yeah, yeah, let's make a toast, the future looking bright. Wasn't perfect, put that work in just to earn a stripe. I've been working, that's for certain, this ain't overnight.
Look, first they. So for here, like, you know, I'm just going for. It's going for just continuity here. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm thinking about. I'm not sure if I think I got this vocal. I don't think I think that vocal was cut before I got this.
Okay.
So I got this vocal and it kind of had its own sound. It wasn't recorded on my vocal chain.
Right, okay.
So I'm trying to, on this record, bring them into the same realm, you know, the same area, the same sound. So they sound like they're in the same record.
Right. And do you have templates set up for every session, or do you start basic?
I'm looking at this. I kind of start basic. I'll just try to do, you know, the basic EQ compression and try to just, you know, I only do what's necessary. I don't like doing a lot. If I get a vocal or get a record and it sounds good already, I try to do the least amount as possible.
Kind of like fuse it and gel it together, I guess, right? Rather than kind of just add something for the sake of adding something.
Right, right. But this one I had to add quite a bit. So I'm looking at the, you know, because once you finish mixing it, we don't really look at it again. But seeing this, I'm like surprised at some things I'm seeing. But so for his vocal, for Blast's vocal, I was wanted to, you know, get some clarity to it, you know, so I'm giving it the air. You know, 20K is kind of high. And then I'm doing some multi-band compression, you know. EQ, a few bands, you know, dipping some of the highs. And then
use the RVox after that.
RVox to press it forward, you know, give it that you know, in your face feel. Compression, de-essing.
And that's ozone.
Oh, ozone imaging. So I did like, I don't really doing anything. So, yeah.
And Pro L2. Okay, cool. And then you have two limiters on the vocal?
I guess I felt that was necessary. I mean, they're just really doing gain, not really doing much else.
Oh, right, okay.
There's like a little bit of gain there.
Okay, cool. But how come you've had it separate? Is that like a...
I'm not even sure. Maybe it's just something where, you know, I feel like I needed another one. You know what I mean? Sometimes... You feel like you like the way one feels, but you feel like you can limit it a little more sometimes.
Yeah. I guess you can A-B between them as well if you wanted to as well, right?
Exactly.
All right, cool, man. How about... I want to go back a little bit now to the two-track, because that's quite an important thing. A lot of the people that would be kind of watching this as well, again, new generation, a lot of their friends will be chucking in beats and, you know, YouTube beats and stuff like that. Should we maybe look at your kind of vocal effects on... blues vocals, see what we did there? Or any effects you want to talk about?
Yeah, so when I do vocal effects, it's just to fill in space because, you know, artists don't really want to, you don't really want the artist to say, fill in every note, every beat of the song, you want the song to breathe, but also not be bare and feel boring. Right. So, you know, for me, I just try to create space in my records and just kind of give the listener some ear candy that kind of just carries us over to the next time we hear the artist's voice, so we're just not sitting in dead air. So with ad-libs, I got to do the same thing too. So in this one, you have Blast singing the hook, but in the background you have Dame, you know, giving ad-libs.
Right, okay.
So we'll go.
Yeah, perfect timing, that's how you know it's right. Yeah, yeah, let's make a toast, the future looking bright. Wasn't perfect, put that work in just to earn a strike. I've been working, that's for certain, this ain't over.
Look, first they prayed on all my failures, then they showed me love. These just results from my investment, silly shoulder shrugs.
Those are some for that part of the hook, and then in the end of the song, I kind of added some more.
Waited on this moment my whole life. Price ain't cheap, I paid the fee, I had to sacrifice. Wasn't perfect, put that work in just to earn a strike. I've been working, that's for certain, this ain't overnight. Yeah, perfect timing, that's how you know it's right. Yeah, yeah, let's make a toast, the future looking bright.
And here in the end.
Say, oh, this wasn't overnight. Oh, this wasn't overnight.
Wow. So all the backings are going into a bus? Like all these kind of throws and stuff.
Yeah, all these kind of effects. Yeah. I have everything kind of like a reverb or a delay. I have it all like, you know, going to an effects bus. I can mute all the effects if I need to. A lot of times I kind of just treat it like I'll just use audio and Pro Tools and just print it, audio suite it. Like be like, oh, I like that note, like that word, and just stop a delay on it and print it.
Wow.
I mean, that's what you're seeing here. I'll just stop a delay on it. I'll just print it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'll put a reverb, you know, or whatever, a chorus, a flange. I'll just like, put that together. Try it. And if I like it, just print it. So that's what you see in here is just me printing and trying stuff, basically.
Oh, that's sick. That's a good idea, man. Of like, I think like printing effects and stuff is so important. Earlier I was talking about kind of like, just as a engineer, how much involvement do you have in the creative process of effects? Like, is it your thing?
Usually,
like,
for me, it's my thing. A lot of artists don't really want to sit there and create effects. They kind of expect you to kind of do it as they go. And just kind of have it, because a lot of artists have what we call demo-itis. So like when the artist finishes the song, artist says, you know, they'll sometimes do more than one song in a session. And they'll just say, okay, cool, close out, let's go to the next one. And you'll close it. And before they leave the studio, they want that, you know, we're spoiled now. So, you know, we all want to listen to the bounce, listen to the mix on the way to the car, to the, yeah. To the house, or whatever. So we want that instant yeah. gratification of, I want to hear what I just created as artists. So, you know, we'll make a bounce, send it right to the phone. And so that version usually kind of, usually not ends up being the final version, but a lot of artists get really attached to their first creation.
Demo artists is a real thing, man.
It really
is. It really is. And then as an engineer as well, another thing that I wanted to ask was, a lot of projects are done in certain doors, certain things. Mm-hmm. Would you prefer a project so you can finalize that project and finish it off? Or would you prefer stems, no plugins on?
I like to receive whatever the producer's or artist's vision is. I like to see it, receive it as close to that as possible.
Okay.
I don't like to have to try to go and recreate someone else's vision to kind of do something. If they already did the work and did the creativity, let's pick it up, you know, from where they left mm-hmm. off, and let's move it forward.
Wow. Okay.
I don't like to overproduce, overmix, overprocess, and overthink things. I like to just keep it, you know, keep it fluid.
Keep it simple, right?
Yeah. Keep it simple. Important. So if they've you know, they're working in some other program, just please just give me the audio file that match what you already did in that program, so we can put it in Pro Tools and keep pushing.
Yes, I like that. I like that. Awesome, man. Well, I kind of definitely want to touch on your two-track stuff because okay. it's so important.
Yeah.
Grabbing a YouTube beat.
Yeah. Right. Exactly.
Have you ever worked with like an MP3 that's come from YouTube?
Yeah. It's rough.
So you know the feeling of that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Maybe, yeah, I mean, this is probably not an MP3, obviously, but...
But, you know, this is, shout out Khalil, incredible producer, Kendrick Lamar,
wow.
Mad Grammys, this guy's amazing.
Yeah.
Shout out Khalil, you're amazing.
Khalil is great.
Legend. So, you know, for this one, you know, when he sends a beat, it's just already sounding like...
Fire, right?
Ready
so would he leave his master, like all the master stuff already done?
Yeah, his master's like whatever got sent to the, whatever got sent over is what we go with. So it's like, you know, it's like, it's pretty simple.
And you send that to a bus?
Yeah, sometimes because like for this one, like, you know, I think I did an effect or a filter here.
The real ones know it's more.
I keep a mental part of the track. So yeah, I did a low pass and this part of the beat during the verse. So it's just easy if I have it all. And then and this, I don't even know why I have this. Let me look and see what we're going on.
So you automated the filter?
I didn't automate the filter.
You just had it there?
Yeah, sometimes I'll take the beat and put it on separate tracks, like these three here.
That's so smart.
And I'll just, you know, throw it down. Okay. So it's all going to the same place.
Yep. Real ones
know it's but that one has a filter on it. This one has another filter.
One knob is so sick. I was talking about it earlier.
Right.
Dude. It's crazy, but I just love anything to make life easier.
Yes.
just quick, easy, one knob. The driver, the pumper.
Yeah.
You want to use that one?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And absolutely. So yeah, that's why I have those separated.
Yeah.
Speaking of two tracks, so I'll just cut the two track up.
Okay.
And then goes to a bus. On the bus, I'm doing some EQ, throwing off some low end, peeking some different spots for, you know.
And how did you find these spots? Can I just ask?
I'm just kind of soloing peaks? Frequencies. Like, okay. I'll just hit these little solo.
And what sounds harsh, you're just cutting out?
Cutting it out. And if I feel like it needs a boost a little something, I'll boost it.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, because you've opened up a little bit there as well. Mm-hmm. All right.
And then here, I'm just doing some stereo EQ.
Okay.
Dipping some mids, some low mids there in the middle channel. And here, what we got here? L2.
Wow, it's actually quite minimal there as well, right? But I guess, again, you said like Khalil would have stuff set and obviously great producer.
Right.
So,
But
obviously you get some that would be insane, right? Where you'd have to do a lot more stuff.
Yeah, but you have to chop, you know, again, chop the two track in different sections. So when the verse comes in, you got to filter the beat like this.
Oh my God, dude,
you know,
that's crazy.
Edit the beat like that, which is real life. Because, you know, we're all inspired. We're all artists and we're not always on that level yet, so we got to make do what we got,
100%
at the house, you know.
It's crazy though, because like I've had this thing before where people don't think that engineers are creative at all. It's just like we're seen as this person sitting in the chair, which we are, of course, with a laptop, whatever it may be, or the SSL. But a lot of the time, we are very heavily involved in the creative side of things.
Absolutely.
This is being creative. Yeah. Like, when you're chopping and moving things around, it's creative.
You're being creative.
The artist is like, no, but I need this, but I need the 60, not the 8, but it's standard or whatever it may be.
100%.
You got to chop it up.
Going back to what you were saying earlier, for those of us that are starting out or just the newer people, like it's just whatever sounds good. There's no rules to this.
Yeah.
Like, just do what we got to do, whatever we got to do, and just try. Like all this stuff. As I'm looking at this session, I'm like, I may not mix this song like this today. I'd be like, I may not do that, but I was trying whatever I felt was right at that moment, and I was just going with it. You know, to get it done by the deadline where it had to be done. You know.
Yeah.
So yeah.
And have you ever kind of like done a mix and you've not been happy with it, but it's had to go. And
yeah,
it's just the deadlines of the labels are strict. Yeah.
And no, it happens all the time. I've got songs right now that need to be. I've got songs that just I need to have it mastered and mixed by Monday.
Ooh.
I don't have all the vocal files. Ooh. They need it mixed and mastered by Monday, and at most mixed. I don't even have the session yet. So it's like, you know, you don't necessarily get the luxury of time.
Wow.
To because as creatives we can be perfectionists and we want things to be perfect, but you know, for me.
Yeah,
not always the case, but you know, knowing my DAW, knowing my Pro Tools, knowing what I'm listening through is makes it easier because I can at least just know how to get there quicker.
Right, exactly. Yeah. And obviously, like you've also got like you said, you got to know your DAW, know your tools, and kind of know roughly where you want the project to get to. Mm-hmm. Right. So like referencing is very important.
Yes. Yes.
Do you use stuff like Metric AB?
I do actually had
you
a
do?
Session. I literally took it out, which is funny.
Oh,
yeah,
wow. Okay.
Yeah, it's funny.
Which is great.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah. Great.
A tool like that is just really, really essential. Yeah. But you're right, man. And what about Stream Deck? Are you kind of into that stuff yet?
No. I haven't done a lot of Stream Deck stuff yet.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I've seen it a lot recently with the whole macros and setting up things and just making your session. It's like having an assistant.
Yeah.
But in macro form. So you can just press buttons and, you know, you could get to the point quicker.
Right.
And then what's on your submix? Can we have a look at that?
I don't even know. We're going to find out together. I've got the L2.
Okay.
L3, excuse me.
Wow, okay.
Doing 4. Another L2 here. Doing a little bit. Pro Q.
Okay, of course. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I'm cutting this out, clearing out room for the vocal. That's what I'm doing here.
Oh, okay. Wow, okay. Mm-hmm.
So that's for. We're doing,
so that's to make room for the vocal.
Exactly.
Wow, that's pretty cool.
And then compression, the light compression.
Uh-huh. Real ones know it's more difficult. I keep a mental note. The trenches wow, be different, like, bro.
It's barely moving.
Wow, the needle's like
it's half a dB, you know what I mean? Something real light.
Well, Nate, I think that's perfect. Thank you so much for showing the session.
Thank you.
Honestly, like again, we appreciate it, man. Like I know how hard it is to clear songs and to get sessions and through them.
I definitely had more songs that I wanted to bring, but you know,
it is hard.
Getting the artist to clear them is not as
easy. Oh, of course, man. This is amazing. And of course, bro, good luck for everything you're doing, man.
Appreciate you.
We talk a fair bit now.
We do. And thank you, guys. Thank you for your help and everybody at the company. You guys,
we love it. We just want to appreciate great music and people obviously put in a lot of time and effort to using our tools.
Yeah, absolutely.
So thank you, Nate.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you guys out there.
Thank you, guys.
Yeah, we'll see you soon.
Absolutely.
Cheers, man.
Yeah.
Cheers, guys.